Hello and good evening. It's Monday evening in the United Kingdom. My name is Terry Randall. I'm an executive producer of Time of the Sixth Sun. In the window below is Nikki Luna Williams, who is the writer, the creator, the producer of this amazing series, the movie and eight-part documentary series. And in the window over here, we have Mr. Marc Cuthbert, who's joining us a lot earlier in the day where he is in the world. Nice to have you with us, Marc.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. Very nice to be here. Thanks.
Whereabouts are you?
Canada, Nova Scotia, East Coast.
Oh, nice, nice. Beautiful. Halifax time. So it's earlier in the day for you. So yeah, our Monday evening is almost over, but we have people joining us from all over the world, and we love to know where you're from. So just if you're watching right now, just ping your country in from the in the comments. Daniel's coming in from Arizona, and while we're waiting for people to join us, what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring up Marc's details right just up here, because we're going to be talking about all sorts of exciting things. So if you want to find out more about Marc, I'm going to put these links in the comments. But we've got quantumpowermunich.de, which is the German website, www.quantumgravityresearch.org. And if you're interested in finding out what Marc does and more about Marc, you can email him, Marc Cuthbert with a C, or two C's, at protonmail.com. So we'll put all those details up. And if you're just joining us for the first time, or you're watching this on replay, we have the ability for you to watch Time of the Sixth Sun, the movie, and the eight-part documentary series free for a limited time. You just need to go to our website, www.timeofthesixthsunlaunch.com, enter your name, enter your email, and then we'll add you to the list, and we'll let you know when the next launch is going to be. They're frequent, so just sign up and you can get access to that. So yeah, it's so nice to see you again, Marc, and thanks so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
One of the last times we all met up, we went to see Michael Tellinger's talk in London.
Yes. Yeah. Fascinating.
Yes, I was talking with Michael just a couple of days ago, so I'll expect we'll come to that during the conversation. Yeah. Or Ubuntu, at least in principle.
Exactly.
So over to you, Nikki.
Yeah, fantastic. So going to be a little bit long-winded of how we met, because in the book that I'm writing, Marc, Filmmaking Guided by Spirit, I talk about the many synchronicities that we faced in the making of the film, spirit guidance that we received. And one of those sweet moments of serendipity is the fact that you and I, Marc, were connected way before we ever met in regard to the film. And one of the first ceremonies we filmed in Mexico was to fulfill a 500-year-old prophecy. And they asked people around the world to participate and to register that they would be drumming and how many people would be drumming so they could accurately fulfill the prophecy. So there were people from Japan and Belgium and England, Holland, and also Hong Kong, who, by our own request, they sent us their footage then of their little ceremonies to put in the film. So fast forward a few years later, and I met Marc, and in passing, he mentioned that he was a skipper of a Chinese junk in Hong Kong Harbour. And I was thinking, this is really ringing a bell. And I said to you, did you participate in a ceremony? There was a bit of like not remembering.
Yeah, I remember that one.
So I dug out the old footage, and bingo, there was Marc, 2004, being smudged and gonged on your junk for the ceremony for our film. Fantastic. Right.
That junk was the Kublai Khan, which was about 100 to 110 foot, four-masted junk, converted from an Indonesian Pinsi by a German adventure group. And they were retracing the steps and making a movie. I think it came out with National Geographic, but they were doing retracing the steps of Kublai Khan. And so they'd had this converted in the Philippines, and because of my reputation for junk sailing, had flown me over there to skipper the junk and teach them how to sail it effectively. So I brought them from the Philippines to Hong Kong and hosted them there for a couple of weeks. We did a lot of fundraising and exposure and public appearances, and they gave some talks. They're well-known adventurers in their field and in Germany, almost celebrities in their status. I was on their junk, and actually it's their junk, the Kublai Khan, that we had the ceremony on. Much bigger, and we could hold about 100 people. playing the drums.
It was amazing. Very noisy from what I remember. So, Mark, you feature, obviously, in the film, telling your story, which we'll come to later. But also, you feature quite heavily in episode 3, Ancient and Future Technologies. And so you've got this huge passion for adventure, Mark, and living life to the full. And so they're two very strong aspects of your character. Are the two synonymous, do you think, with pushing the limits, pushing the boundaries of new frontiers, those two aspects of your life?
They are. I remember while you were talking, and I haven't thought about this since, but there was two occasions where I remember almost a massive leap forward in my outward perception of the world. The first was when I learned to ride a bicycle, and suddenly I could go further from home and mum and dad in the nest than I'd ever been, and it was very, very exciting. And I remember the elation I felt that I suddenly realised I could move about and I was somewhat independent. And the second, in a very similar way, was when I got my first motorcycle. And those horizons expanded even more. And then I suppose there was another occasion when I learned to sail and I did my first ocean crossing. And again, the first time, and I would recommend this experience for anybody, when you have no horizons in sight, no land, and it's just you on this rinky-dink little bit or big boat in the middle of the ocean, in the middle of the night under the stars. So I guess those experiences that elevate that that outlook, yeah.
I guess it elevates everything. So what actually physically happens when you release, as an adrenaline junkie, whether it's sailing or flying a microlight, whatever it is, what do you get? Super sharp in the mind? You get focused and clear? What else do you experience?
Well, I don't know if I'm an adrenaline junkie, but certainly I seek those edges, those boundaries, those limits of personal experience. I'm of the opinion, and many people are, you don't know what a limit is really until you go beyond it and you find out looking backwards, oh, that was the limit. And hopefully it's not a broken boat or something that tells you that.
That was the line I shouldn't have crossed.
Yeah, exactly. So I guess, there's that element of feeling alive. It dilates your awareness. And focuses your reality to your perception that's right in front of you. You're fully engaged in a sense, and it's I think it's common to a lot of those adventure and adrenaline experiences that you're fully engaged, meaning you're fully present. And if you're fully present, I think there's connection between spirit and all the different levels within you, and your chakras all start to align up and shiver and shake and dance together. When you have that sense of presence and awareness, not just self-awareness, but connected awareness with everything around you. And then that enhances your sense of just being alive. Which leads to gratitude.
I guess also with the adrenal pumping, you get a lot of dopamine, so you're in joy and all of that. Interesting.
Yeah, and in my experiences, a lot of that is, as you know, being in the face of nature. Not necessarily the extremes, but the magnificence of all that it can present and the mystery of what it presents. And when you find yourself suddenly in a part of that, and I've had experiences at sea, for example, where I've had weather systems come at me in the dark, where you can't see anything. It's more of a sense. And there was one time in the South China Sea, and there was a black squall coming towards us, and you could smell the ionization of the air. And you could feel the temperature slowly dropping. So it was a multi-sensory experience. And I had no idea what was going to happen. You couldn't see anything, but you knew it was coming. And there was a silence in the air, sort of an electrification. And then you could hear it as it got close enough. You could hear it like a train coming at us with that hard squall line at the front. And when it hit, it was like a wall, hitting a wall. But we'd prepared the boat. I was on the catamaran at the time. So I prepared the boat, lashed everything down, everybody inside. I mean, it was like we were preparing for a big hit, and we were. So we were in good stead, and once it hit, we were fine, and we just rocketed along. I had a handkerchief of a sailor, and we were doing 17, 18, 20 knots and you can almost water ski behind that. So, wow. So it's like, oh, this is great, this is great. So there's the fear and the expectation and the unknown all wrapped up into this amazing wow.
Yeah, I see why you do it.
It's also quite scary though, isn't it? When you're the vulnerability that comes with a moment like that, where you are absolutely in the arms of the elements, where you've got no control over it, and you do not have that safety of being on dry ground and on land, where you think actually, you know, if it all gets really bad, I can just curl up in a little ball and hide. But you can't do that on a boat.
Yeah, or call somebody and or get out of here. But yeah, you're suddenly very vulnerable, like you say, and it's a humbling experience, but also elated.
Yeah.
And makes you appreciate the immense power of nature. You know, and it makes you appreciate the immense power of nature. And all of those experiences in their individual ways, I think, draw you closer in that relationship with nature.
Yeah. It's a respect for it, isn't it?
Indeed, yeah.
And so safety, is safety an illusion, Mark? Do you think?
Interesting question. I think safety is not always at the forefront of your mind when you embark on some sort of adventurous experience. It's a component that, if you know, due diligence keeps close to you as you embark and prepare for an experience, if you do indeed prepare, or it doesn't come upon you suddenly. But I think, yeah, safety, the aspect of safety gets stronger as we get older, I think, as our mortality sort of.
Yeah, as we lose our invincibility a bit, I think.
Yeah, indeed. That's an amazing thing when we're younger, isn't it, that you have that invincible feeling. You don't necessarily consciously say, I'm invincible, I'll do it all. You just do it. You get on with it. You don't have those blockages.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of the inventive, the intuitive process of technologies as well as adventure, is to try and remove some of those blockages that prevent intuition and some of the finer aspects of being enter into your present consciousness.
Yeah. Horses was my thing. You don't go so fast.
Horses. The last time I rode a horse, I actually, we were running pretty fast, and he jumped a ditch, and I got bounced off, and I found myself being dragged upside down with my foot caught in the stirrup. Didn't do my knee much good.
No. So I remember, Mark, you turning up on my doorstep, I don't know if you recall, with a full neck brace and a spinal brace. Because why?
Aviation mishap.
Come on.
Well, as Teo knows, we share this passion, and we've talked about this. I have a flying inflatable boat, which is essentially a rib with a microlight Rotax engine on it, a two-seater. That's the one.
I've got a picture.
What, Teo?
No, I said I found the picture. I've put the picture up. It's quite small, but you can still see that.
Yeah. So that's the one. So I love flying that around. Had some great experiences in that. Mine is slightly different to that model in that it has wheels that are on swan necks. So you can pull a cord and the wheels can pop up. So just in case there's no water nearby or you need to make an emergency landing, you just pop them down and Bob's your uncle, so they say. So we were in Norfolk, and I had an engine failure. Excuse me, at about 800 feet, 900 feet. So there's not much time to glide down and find a spot. So in pilot training, as you're flying along, you're taught always to keep an eye open for a plan B in case all fails. And that had stuck with me. So there wasn't much choice at 800 feet, but a beautiful cornfield, a ripe, tall cornfield. So I thought, well, that'll make a nice splash landing. And I had jolly friend in the back, so I had to be extra careful. So it was a classic textbook landing in that sense, and we just glided down, brushed across the top of the corn. I never did meet the farmer, fortunately, but did apologise, you know, put it out there. So we landed in the corn, I checked through everything, and I think there was just an air bubble in the fuel. So started again first time, so I drove it to this grass strip between the two fields, and there was a slight crosswind, but not much. But as you then take off, Your wheels, of course, get lighter just before liftoff. And as they do, the crosswind, because it was only about 10 foot wide, drifted us slightly, so the wheel caught into the trough at the beginning of the field and dragged us into the field and just flipped us over and threw me out and snap. So broke my my neck in a couple of places.
He was back on his feet, and within 6 weeks you were doing it again.
fall off the horse and get straight back on. And this, the most amazing thing was that just after I met Luna, I went to train to do my paragliding training, and a friend of mine sent me a picture of this boat, and he was like, Teo, once you've done the paragliding training, he said, this is the next thing you need to do. You need to find yourself whoever made this, and you've got to go and get yourself a flying boat, he said, because that looks great fun. And so I was talking to Luna about it, and she went, you know what? And I went, what? I went, Marc Cuthbert, he's the man that owns that boat. And I was like, you are kidding. And she was like, no. And then there was the synchronicities. And then we ended up meeting and chatting, and I was like, I know about all about your flying boat, because other friends have sent me pictures of it saying, you've got to try that next. I mean, talk about small world. It's incredible.
I know, it's great. I know. I'm sorry I haven't had a chance to take you up in it yet, but I'm actually going to bring it out here to Canada, because we can fly from just outside the house here on the river. So we should do that once things clear up.
What fun. I'll get in the gym and start strengthening up my neck. Ready for the crosswind.
Please don't. It's not a mistake I shall make again.
So the great adventurer painting this picture. So in the film, Mark, our narrator Tobias, he talks about our fruit of the rose moment, which his definition of that which we have put in place long before we ever came to Earth in order to awaken ourselves. And so for those of who want to hear your full story, it's actually part of the bonus series within the digital package that we sell. So that's Mark telling the whole story beginning to end. So in a nutshell, Mark, in hindsight, what do you think precipitated your eventual release by the pirates, the Somali pirates, who are quite fearsome, when your fate could so easily have been death? What was the crux? I mean, you can talk about it a little bit. Talk about the story.
Okay. Well, yeah. Well, I won't go into too much detail. As you say, it's available. There were probably two, maybe three times during that experience that death was so close. And we'll come back to that, because that's an interesting place to find yourself, with it knocking on the door and hearing that knock and knowing it. So basically, what we were taken by the pirates, and as you say, they can be quite fierce, but also I learned that they're very confused and very anxious, and most of all, very desperate. And really, that's the motive for their whole pirate thing. They're absolutely desperate, and they historically they blamed it on fishing and invasion of by sea and people from different peoples. But at the end of the day, this is what they know and what they feel is the most prosperous way out of their predicament. Mm. So I think one of the turning stages within that process was getting to know them a little bit, getting to realize and see some of those qualities
within that process.
Getting and appreciate their life status and why they were doing this, and not feeling victimized. That was quite a move to move myself out of the victim role. And suddenly I found myself being empathic towards their position and their situation.
Yeah, I was going to say, it sounds like compassion came in.
Yeah, well, I realized this must be really difficult for you. This must be really tough. First of all, you don't really want to be doing this to me and my crew. I mean, you didn't get up this morning, surely, thinking, you know, I want to go out and shoot some guns and hijack some poor kids off the ocean. I got to think that they are just like us in so many ways. They have all the same troubles in life, the same challenge, not all the same. I don't want to minimize at all the strife that they face, because it's horrendous in different scales. But in essence, the troubles that they face lead them to different places, and they have different intensities. And I've tried to find ways just to relate to them. So to your point, to your question, I think turnaround came through creating relationship, and not just a relationship where they were the predator and I was the victim, but try to normalize it into one of equality based on humanity. Mm. Once I found a few keys to do that, we started talking about, because we had like 2 days of chats, chats, interrogation, whatever it is. And they were stealing stuff and they had, you know, guns in our ears and all sorts of stuff. And, you know, one of the young guys, he was obviously chewing a ball of cat in his cheek. So he's high on that and adrenaline rushed and everything. He was probably only 14, 15, poor guy. You know, while he had a gun in my nose sort of thing, he ripped off a St. Christopher that I was wearing and just took that. And they basically were in a position where they were dominant and they felt they could do whatever they want and take whatever they want, and this was their domain. And I could see there was no concept for our position. So I wanted to try and turn that around as well. So I would choose issues of family, children, home, difficulty, blah, blah, food, you know, whatever commonality I could find, and try and strike a chord or at least conversation, because as soon as you start exchanging, you can build on that relationship. So we played a little psycho tennis backwards and forwards, but ultimately, again, not to go into too much detail, after a couple of days, we were actually having some pleasant conversations, and their chief was asking questions of me not related to the circumstance and situation, and we'd struck an accord where there was a newfound respect from his side, such that after I'd related the story and we talked about theft, and taking what's not yours and asking for help for what you need and all this sort of stuff, because I've gone through a process of gifting him some things with batteries and making him understand how to change them, how it works, and here's a manual, and you know, if you're going to have it, you might as well do it well, do it properly, and I can help you with that. So just slowly, brick by brick, developing a respect exchange. Suddenly, this guy, this young guy, was back in front of me, and I hadn't seen him. And they chatted in Somali, and he gave me voluntarily back the necklace.
Oh.
My jaw dropped. I was absolutely flabbergasted. I knew then that we'd gone through a turning point, and this was a whole different situation now. And in the end, as it turned out, they helped us to leave. His guys were helping me pull the sails up and drop the anchor. And by the end of it, actually, we pulled away so fast, because it was a racing boat, that their boats couldn't keep up with us. And so they were jumping over the side and swimming back to their own boats. It was quite a sight. Yeah. But none of us on the boat talked for 8-10 hours at least. We were all just that shock afterwards, the allowing the chemicals and the adrenaline and everything to just letting it settle in. Wow. It was like we just got through a new reality and an awakening, you know.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people don't return. A lot of people don't return from those scenarios with the Somalis. I mean, I remember I lived on Lamu for over a year, and Manda Island that we would literally swim over to, and Kiwayu Island, you know, people were taken and they didn't make it back, you know. Kidnapped and died.
I watched the movie Captain Phillips who's the actor? It's not Dan Aykroyd. Anyway, it was a kidnapping scenario on a commercial ship off Somalia, and had me in tears. I was just so brought it all back, the way they were behaving, throwing the guns around, and just total disrespect for life, really. But still. Reserved in a sense that their inner being, their inner core, didn't really want to be there doing this, and they knew that. You could pick it up. You can see it in their fear, in their eyes.
Yeah,
it's an amazing story, Mark. You know, Helen saying it was Tom Hanks. I hadn't seen that, but it's how many people in that situation would just go into that fright mode of just staying quiet, and actually, it was incredibly intelligent to then try to. appeal to their better judgment, and for you to have the outcome that you had, because as Luna said, you know, you hear so many horror stories of what happens in that situation, because as you're right, they're doing what they need to do, because they feel that there are no other options.
Yeah, Yeah. No, we were very fortunate. I'm so in such gratitude that it ended that way for us. And it could have gone any number of ways.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's really a situation that brings you into absolute presence rather than victim, like you said.
Well, another point that actually turned that for me and put me into that space, Teo, was when they first took us and they put us in the hold of their boat, which was basically a hatch in the deck that opened up, threw us all in the bottom. We're just in shorts, you know, it's hot tropical weather, middle of the night. And we found ourselves in complete darkness, sliding around as if the floor was covered in oil and water. And then the next time the hatch opened with the light that came in, we could see once our eyes were adjusted that this was full of rays and dolphins and sharks and God knows, all these huge, big monster fish beings. And we could see teeth glistening and eyes glistening around us in the dark. God. All dead, fortunately. I mean, but we were literally just sliding around in these, not knowing where our hands were going. So to be in the dark in that experience is almost like nothing you can imagine. It creeps you out just thinking about it.
Oh, it does.
So, and in that space, of course, you've got you don't know how much time you've got. So all these qualities of self are jostling for position in your focus. And some of those components are instinctive, survival, rational mind trying to come in. I was calculating, do we have the skills between us and the ability to take these guys on? How would we come out of this? What if somebody got killed? You know, how would we reflect on this? And I chatted it through with the guys, and in that moment, that's when the fruit of the rose, if you like, and the surrender, the awareness, the vulnerability you were talking about earlier was absolutely, I don't know if there's a word to describe it, but it was paramount and foremost, that vulnerability. So if all the cloak of ego and what you think you can do, all of these thoughts I had, just had to let it all go. It's like, you know what? What's going to happen is happening. And I remember that like blanket of calmness just came over me. It's nothing I can do. Deep breath. And let's just deal with this as it happens, sort of thing.
And how were the other guys? Because I mean, obviously, it must have taken incredible leadership from you as the captain to take over that role of I've got to try and negotiate us out of this situation. But how were the others? Were they once you sort of held it and you were beginning to build this relationship and to beginning to negotiate? Did the others follow suit, or did they just stay quiet, or how did they react in that situation? How did the group dynamic play out?
My instinct, I didn't even have a thought about it. I knew I felt responsible, and I felt like the action and the outcome to some degree was down to how I chose to handle it, regardless. And I knew, even talking to them, that they were probably going to follow along and take the path, the course that I was going to set. Nonetheless, consultation is very important and also inclusive, because we need to feel together as a team. And we need to be coherent in whatever activity we were going to do. Mm-hmm. My approach wasn't going to work if they were going to upset the apple cart and do something stupid. So so they through conversation, they did look to me, and we did, we actually acted well together. It was a good team. Brilliant. In terms of our approach and response. They were really good. They were quiet, though. They were very quiet from time to time. They did not know what to think or how to respond or how to act. And I knew I had to take those reins. I had to lead. Mm. And that was to be called upon to lead in a situation which is life-threatening is a unique experience.
Yeah.
Mm. People looking to you. And like I said, we were just in shorts, which adds to that, the physical sensation then adds to your feeling overall of vulnerability.
Yeah.
Which makes it so sensual,
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amazing. So, Mark, as I mentioned on the fly, you've got your private pilot's license and a micro light pilot. You're an advanced paddy diver. It's an amazing resume, a yacht master and captain and owner of a 65-foot traditional Chinese junk, which we're going to look at in a moment, a 110-foot steel brig square rig ship, the 100-foot sloop, and your 1986 ocean racing catamaran. Is that what you were on at the time, the catamaran?
Yes.
Yeah. And gosh, you remind me of an Errol Flynn character. Swashbuckling. So Taya's going to bring up a slide for us, and we're just going to spend 40 seconds or so if we just watch it, and then we'll come back in.
Okay.
So this is Mark bringing the, he sailed all the way over 6 months from Hong Kong to London in the junk.
Precious Dragon.
What an adventure. Lovely. 6 months. That's amazing. So,
well, it shouldn't have been 6 months.
Sorry?
It shouldn't have been 6 months.
No, you got held up slightly. So, did they get to raise Tower Bridge for you?
They did twice. Once when we went in and we sailed under it. And probably a junk, an Oriental junk, original, sailing under Tower Bridge under full sail was maybe never been done before.
Yeah.
And then the Times newspaper caught a lovely photo of us passing under full sail in front of the Tower of London, which was on page 3, I think, or something, page 5.
Would you like to see that?
Yeah, I love it if you got it.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, lovely. So, yeah, and so from there we went up.
Went up where?
Oh, we have frozen. How many planets?
There, it's Belfast.
Okay. Oh, we just lost you, Mark.
You've lost me?
Yes, we lost you. You froze.
There you go.
We can hear you, but just keep talking. We'll wait for your picture to refresh.
I'm looking back on my screen. I can see me on the on there. It all looks good.
Okay, well, so you stopped London traffic with your junk, and then afterwards did you get to sail her back to Hong Kong?
No. Oh. In the end, she was shipped back to Hong Kong. I rented it to a UK explorer, Rex Warner. He borrowed it for a year to retrace the steps of the Unicameral, Chinese Unicameral, Zheng He, who had... must have been about 400 foot, his junk, and that his film of that was definitely on National Geographic, so that can be watched. You can look that up. He got sponsorship from Costco, and I sailed it up to, I think it was Folkestone, and they put it on a container on the back of the ship and then shipped it over to Hong Kong. So he started his journey there and then sailed it to the Middle East. And that was quite amazing in Hong Kong. I had to go and meet it in the container yard, container port. And I had to be on the boat for it to get put back in the water. So there's this huge crane lifting it off the back of the ship. And I was on board on the deck on this flying junk. didn't have the sails up, obviously, but a flying junk. It must have been 150, 200 feet in the air, because you know how tall these things are. And then flying over the water, it was pretty spooky, I can tell you. And then lowering us down slowly into the water, because then I've got to start the engines and do all that kind of thing and take it away.
That's really funny. So is there a way we can get Mark's picture back, or does it just catch up with itself? Because you're frozen at the moment for us.
Oh, I see.
He's looking great for me, Luna. I think it's just we've got random internet stuff going on today. Mine's crashed 3 times at home, 4 times at home. Okay. So Mark is moving for me.
Okay.
Yeah, you all look fine on mine too.
Is everyone else seeing Mark moving? Maybe it's just me. Okay, so well, we'll keep on. Jeffrey Hoppe, who is the channel for Tobias, our narrator in the film, and but he also channels Adamus. And Adamus recently has kept saying that technology has the power to change humanity, and it will. So, Mark, tell us, where do you see technology going in years to come? So what will we see in our lifetime, or even the next 5 or 10 years? What will we come to accept as the norm?
Well, it's shifting sands at the moment, isn't it? In terms of monitoring public movements and invasion of privacy. And so it's a really tough one to predict. I can talk largely from a place of my experience, and I'm optimistic by nature. So I can vision where it's going to go based on my experiences and some of the work that we've done. Technology itself, of course, has so many branches, and it affects our lives in every single way. My partnership in Seattle in the US, we focused really on sustainable technologies and those that are going to make a difference to impoverished people around the planet and places that need the technology most. And for me, one of the fundamental components of technology that needs addressing, and of course, is clean water, sustainable food sources, housing, all kinds of issues to be dealt with that technology can attend. But for me, my fascination is in energy. I think once we get to a place where energy becomes freely and readily available and ubiquitous to all places on the planet and all technologies that require power, we will sidestep a lot of the corrupt and enslaved power systems, power structures that enslaves us to the requirement for power. Imagine if energy is free to everybody and it's available everywhere. Our vision as a group is that the ultimate solution for energy is that it should be fully embedded in every technology. Your phone, for example, would never need cables. Cables and distribution of energy should be redundant. So my vision of the future is that we won't have a distributed power system. Everything will be localized and independent. Then it'll become one of those components of sovereignty that we like to address in other aspects. If we remove the demand and the enslavement to power requirement from the monetary system, that'll be a huge liberation, power liberation to people, energy liberation. So we'll do away with cables, we'll do away with wiring houses, we'll do away with charging. Battery, the concept of storing energy, should be a thing of the past because it should be available on demand. In the amount that is required in that specific time and place. And we are working on a particular technology that addresses that and relates exactly to that solution. And we can talk about that if you like. And in the free energy world, in the arena, there's so many different approaches to trying to extract and generate energy without consequence to the environment and keep it sustainable and perpetual, which is, of course, a controversial word because it has been misused quite a lot in the energy world. And perpetual motion is a thing that I think is knocked down rather too easily because we really need to define the elements of perpetual. Because if we look at a mechanical perpetual motion system, such as the one which we worked on in Sedona on a buoyancy engine machine, the thing will go forever and ever. Per se, but you have to define the box, the envelope within which that can continue. On a mechanical system, for example, you have wear and tear. You can have bearings issues, erosion issues from friction and so on and so forth. So really we steer away from the perpetual motion context and just get on with the job. We'll let the theorists argue about that.
Mark, is that the image I've got of the machine in Sedona with the...
Yes.
So if I pull that up, is this one?
Yeah. So I was there for 3 years. I partnered with David Sarita, which is why I moved there. And we were going to be looking at anti-gravity, which is another aspect of technology we'll come to. And also the free generation of energy, we should say. Because although energy is free, in my book, what we're really talking about, there's no cost. You don't have to pay anything for it. Mm-hmm. And if we're talking about extracting that energy from the quantum vacuum, then at the moment with our current understanding and concepts of the vacuum itself, I'm not aware of any payment consequence. There's no cost to us in our environment or otherwise. But who knows, you know, we discover the consequences of our actions and our technologies as we go on. I mean, who would have thought about all the radiation issues that we have with phones, for example, and 5G, you know, is something we could get into, but probably not today. All those EMF issues, when the first laptops and things came out, we weren't considering the EMF radiative consequences in our reproductive organs, for example, when you're working on your laptop on your lap. And again, in Sedona with David, we came up with a solution for that. And we created a shield that you could put underneath your laptop to protect you just from that. But I'm starting to ramp on a little bit. But that machine was say again?
You think how many people sit there on the, you know, on their beds or sofas with their laptop on their lap, which is what it's made for, I guess.
Yeah, and the heat you feel from it isn't just the battery discharging power. You know, that's irradiative heat.
Right.
So if you're feeling heat, do something about it.
Yeah, really.
So, Marc, talk us through this machine because it looks fantastic. Can you just talk us a little bit through this this amazing machine?
Sure. I partnered up with a young guy called Josh who was very inventive. He had hundreds and hundreds of ideas. They were just, he was exploding with ideas. And when he'd get excited, you know, he'd be writing them down all down. He had folders of them. We started a company together to build and develop this idea, which was the Buoyancy Engine. He did get a patent for it while we were there. Ultimately, this didn't come to fruition for the simple fact that towards the end, he got rather paranoid. And like a large number of inventors and these creative minds that we have engaged over time, there is... So they can be a substantial psychological issues around these people. And sometimes they do feel that they're being watched and they get paranoid. And they sometimes get afraid of the success, the enormity of the potential that will befall them once this thing gets out and into the public domain. So he slowly psychologically collapsed towards the end of putting this thing together and bailed, basically.
Oh, no.
Yeah, but the thing is here, Tao, that this...
Back into vision.
Say again?
No, I said I'm bringing us back into vision.
Huh. The issue with this, and I was okay to let it go, because it's a mechanical approach to generating free energy. And this model in particular, there were many, many refinements and enhancements we could have gone to, but being mechanical, it would be prone to wear and tear and ongoing maintenance. But the upside of it was, and we both could vision this, was to have, you've seen the FedEx parcels or UPS or whoever it is, and they deliver guy under his arm with a big package, you know, to some remote place in the middle of the desert. And so we had visioned that this thing could actually be boxed up in a package about half the size of a washing machine and delivered to anywhere in the world, third world countries. And you could put it together, literally, maybe we were trying to devise it, not even with a screwdriver. So you could build the whole thing, put it together if we designed and constructed it right, a public version, commercialized version. And all you would need is water. And then you just fill half of it up with a hose. And then the thing starts moving on its own.
Wow.
And should keep going on its own. But interestingly enough, years later, I came across a video from a company in Australia who had built one of these, and I think it was about 20 or 25 feet high, a commercial application with a generator and so on attached. So I know that it could be commercialized. But there, like this, there's so many solutions that are mechanical and stepping stones towards the ultimate solution. And for me, the ultimate solution must have no moving parts. It mustn't consume anything and therefore be independent. It must be transportable, and it must be have the ability for ubiquitous application and embedment within the machine. And I was saying earlier that we foresee in the future, back to your earlier point, we'll have phones that will never need to be plugged in. They can always be on. They'll never run down. Same with your laptop, and I think everybody watching will be fed up with both of those scenarios. Electric cars, your TV, your washing machine, you name it, whatever you've got will not have any wires, no cables, no plug-in, it'll just be there and on whenever you need it. So that's our ultimate vision. And the technology that we're developing in Germany, inshallah, will address that and provide solution to that.
How exciting.
And what about free energy, Mark, in relation to the Tesla technology, free electricity, which was then the resistance that met?
Well, yeah, the Tesla, what was the industrialist's name? But Tesla was, of course, knocked down for commercial reasons. All his funding got pulled because they realized that they couldn't charge for it if his technology came about. And he was, and we're looking at the tower in Colorado, Wolfendale, I think it's called the tower, where he was drawing from atmospheric energy. He was looking at relationship again with planet Earth and our environment, and he was drawing from that. Because effectively, we are living on a huge generator, the Earth spinning around, is its own generator. Between its surface and the molten core and the static in the atmosphere. There is so much energy and power there that he was found a way of drawing from. Yeah. And had he not been suppressed, the world would be a very, very different place now.
Mm. Is that when you spoke to us about pulling energy from the quantum vacuum? Is that what you're referring to?
No, because he was pulling from the atmosphere and okay. He was drawing from the environment around us, the physical environment, our 3D world. What I'm talking about, the quantum vacuum, is a non-tangible source. It's the ether. It was that frustration that Einstein referenced, but couldn't qualify and quantify in his equations. So it's from that source, which is ubiquitous and an infinite, potentially, is the best way of describing it, source of energy. But when we talk about an energy, we don't necessarily fully understand the energy that is within the quantum vacuum. What we know and what we can conceive is the transformation of that energy through, as in our principles from the lab in Germany and Marcus Reed's work, and you can read that in his book. We're talking about the transformation of the all-pervasive energy of the quantum vacuum into an observable energy. So it's all there and it's all a potential source, but it's not an energetic component that we could define and quantify in our conventional scientific thinking. All we can do, the best we can do, is observe the effects of it and lean towards transforming it into a usable source of energy. And in those principles, which, if you like, we can talk about, is to do with the concept of virtual particles and their transmutation through energetic relationship with subatomic particles in our 3D world, in our real world. Real world. Yeah.
Mark, you've lost me.
I've lost Mark. I can't see Mark, and it's quite hard sitting here when I can't see anything. So do I just refresh, Teo, and I'll just disappear and come back again?
Yeah, let me remove you, Luna, and we'll carry on chatting. And then, refresh and come back.
Can you tell us about your current work in Germany, Mark, while I'm off?
Sure. I saw a quick flash of a slide come up there, and there's nothing proprietary about that that I need to worry about. But it was an example that...
Shall I bring that up? Is that the one? This one?
Yeah. We one of the processes... that we employ to generate nano layers of various materials is a process called sputtering. And it does require some pretty advanced and expensive machinery, but it allows you to build on the sort of mesophysical scale, that is between nanoparticles and let's say 10 to the minus 9 to 10 to the minus 6. Meters in size, so micrometers to nanometers. So we can build layers of materials and observe and experiment with their interactions to try and observe the effects we're looking for. Are you still hearing me okay?
Yeah, we've got you fine. Yeah, and what is the effect that you're looking for, and how will that be used in our day-to-day lives?
When I was working in Seattle, I was introduced to Marcus Reed, the inventor. Now we were he was in version one then. We found him some private funding, a lot of funding, which has worked really well, and it's allowed us to set up a nanotechnology lab in Germany, where I worked. I helped set up and work there for the first year, getting it running, and there we're trying to develop the second generation of the crystal cell technology. Now, crystal cells are something that was ignited originally, at least in my world, by John Hutchison. And there's been a lot of research by a lot of different people trying to make and replicate the effect of the crystal cells that he had. So in our case, what our partnership would try to do in Seattle is to validate a technology and replicate it and reproduce it in our own lab. So Marcus, we flew him over and he showed us how to make and build these crystal cells, which looked essentially like a large battery. If you remember the big C-type battery, D-type, the massive ones. Yeah. Well, if you imagine two of those stacked on top of each other, they were about that size. And with one of those, we could generate about, the good ones, we could generate 2 to 3 milliwatts. Which doesn't sound like a lot of power, but the interesting thing is that this power was continuous, and he'd had one of these running for 19 years, wow, and it was still putting out the same power. Now, the way it was doing that, and once again, it brings us around to that beautiful concept of relationship, because here we, Marcus investigated and created a relationship between that mystical and amazing component water with the quantum vacuum by trapping water molecules in carbon nanotubes. And what would happen is that the molecules vibrate and they're all singing and dancing and jiggling around within the crystalline lattice structure. And as what's making them do that is that they seem to have, or he discovered, that they have this unique relationship with the fluctuations of the quantum vacuum. And these are very, very high fluctuations, and they're frequencies to do with the atomic scale or subatomic scale. Mm. And so some harmonic of that fluctuation frequency would stimulate and create a harmonic resonance with the water molecules that were trapped. And they would jigger around and jigger around. And what that would do was deform momentarily and in a vibrational pattern, the structure, the lattice structure. And as that happened, we would get ions released into the structure, which we could then entrain and turn into, ultimately, without going into too much detail, an electrical current. And that electrical current, in this case, powered an LED light bulb, or two LED light bulbs, or a mini fan from one of these cells. So that was stage one, and Roland and I went to Tesla Tech conference in New Mexico, and we presented the theory and working models. We actually built quite a lot of these in Seattle. Now, the reason why you're not seeing these on your shelves and it hasn't yet hit the world market is because it was version one. It was the discovery of these concepts and also gave us the building blocks and Marcus the background to build a theory, on which he wrote a book, and I had the honor and privilege of editing that, the first edition of the book, Virtual Particles in Electromagnetism. And that's available on the website, which I think was on one of the links you showed.
Yeah.
And that goes into and explains this interactive relationship between the quantum vacuum, and the quasi-crystalline cells that we had created. So the laboratory now is moving on to, with the funding we've had, to research and develop the second generation, because obviously 1 or 2 milliwatts isn't going to go very far.
Yeah.
It does prove the phenomenon,
yeah,
unequivocally. So there's no doubt and there's no question that this works. It's not a debate. It's there and we still have them. What's important is how do we translate that into something miniature that, feeding back into our earlier chats, can be embedded in every technology. You know, you need something that's going to be the size of a watch battery, to so fit
nano,
in there.
Nano, bringing nanotechnology into the design.
Exactly. So we've got to transpose that effect and observation into wafers and multi-layered devices. So that's what we've been doing, and it's highly complex. It's a Pandora's box when you get into material physics and atomic particle physics. It's that was an eye opener for me. I learned a lot.
Yeah. And has that work met with any resistance or not?
Not that we know. We had an interesting visit from a gentleman from MIT, who flew all the way to come and see us. And it wasn't entirely clear what his motives were, whether he was just trying to poach for intellectual property, because we did, we've been through the various stages of patenting the theory and the technology, and we're still working on that now. So ultimately it will be protected, but of course that put us on edge a little bit. We wanted to share, we do want to share, but
yeah.
We're also acutely aware that people do poach and steal technologies and, of course, squish them. There must be so many inventions over the years that have got squished and taken away by the black ops types, the men in black. And before anybody laughs, I didn't used to believe that stuff about the men in black who would come in and just swipe everything and just take it away. But I've done some work with Ralph Ring.
Yeah, lovely Ralph.
Oh, lovely man. Mm. And we became lovely friends. And he used to work with Otis Carr in California at a lab that Otis had set up to follow on some of Tesla's work. Because Otis Carr was basically the last guy initiative, if you like, initiate of Tesla. So he was trying to reproduce some of his anti-gravitic work in the lab and the free energy work. And Ralph was a part of his lab team. So, it was just wonderful to get to know him and learn some of his stories.
It's an amazing story. I mean, he was part of the group where we interviewed Stu the other night, and we talked about gathering together with a medicine man for a week in the Mojave Desert, and Ralph Ring was one of them. And to hear his story about his training and how they actually took off. I mean, this guy was flying around in a little spaceship and he was spotted. He was witnessed in that flight. They brought back matter from where they'd been. It's an extraordinary soil. Story.
Yeah, they filled their pockets with soil and bits of dirt just to show, you know, we've actually been out the craft. When I climbed in the thing, I didn't have anything, right? So here we are.
It was powered up by this massive crystal inside, and they all spent months and months learning to empty their minds, their brains, and then focusing on the center, on this crystal, and when it could change color, a bit like lights do now, when it became aquamarine, that was the point that it would take off. That was the key.
That's right. That's right. And isn't that interesting? You know, again, it comes back to relationships and resonance and frequencies.
Yeah.
Because at some point, if you have a harmonious related frequency exchange, and in his particular case, the craft you were talking about, it turned into jello as it started to transition, if you like. Yeah. And you, although you could still see it, you could put your hand through it.
Wow.
At the same time. And so there's all kinds of phenomenon that we haven't even scratched the surface of in our contemporary sciences.
No. We will get Ralph on the show.
Oh, lovely. Yeah.
So let me just get this right, because I don't think I've heard this before. So he was able to take a little spaceship and with the power of their mind, get the crystal to change color, and then it would levitate.
Yeah, and they
wasn't a little one, it was a big one. They climbed in.
Yeah.
Wow.
It didn't need a power source because they worked on the theory like a bumblebee. The body is too heavy for the wings, so they don't propel themselves. They just are able to rise up and then the earth moves, moving them along. Is that correct, Mark? I can't see Mark, so I'm not
Still here. Well, I couldn't speak to that specifically, but...
Mark, just one second. Let me just remove Mark and then remove you, Luna, and I'll bring you both back in.
It's really difficult.
No, it's just me. Should we bring them back? Yeah. Hold on.
There you are. Thank you. I'll let you know if he freezes again because it's...
Okay.
How good it worked. Well, with the point there with the gravity, and there's that concept, and there were a lot of misnomers, I think, in the early days of these becoming part of the popular culture. Anti-gravity is, I think, a little bit of a misnomer, because in my experience and things that I've come across, it's not really about anti-gravity. It's more about changing your localized environment so you are no longer subject to the force of gravity.
There you go. I like it.
Exactly. Perfect.
It's from that position, you have, if you like, your own space-time sovereignty, or independence. So you're disassociating yourself from the gravitic forces of the planet. And that's how that works.
Yes. Very good.
And not only Ralph, but also John Searle experienced the same effect. And his was a beautiful technology, and it's still being worked on in San Diego. The Searle Magnetics Lab is still doing the research there. And John's, a wonderful person, and deep insight and humility. Yeah. And he's been lovely to work with. I personally invested in his company. I believed in his work that much. And for people that aren't familiar, that again was a magnetic system. It was a moving mechanical system. However, we talked about perpetual motion earlier and the concepts of friction and resistance that are part of the entropic process within that system. With Ralph's system, with John's system, you've got three concentric layers of magnetic rollers.
Yeah.
And we're overcoming those losses by, these are all being suspended in quite a complex but very deliberate magnetic matrix field. So they're spinning around super, super fast of their own accord due to magnetic repulsion and attractive forces. And they're also going in opposite directions. And so there he's approaching a phenomena whereby, and I think this is key to the anti-gravitic, I should stop saying that, the non-gravitic issue, is to create a shearing of forces. Because as you increase the frequency and the intensity of that shearing phase, you start to get new phenomena on that event horizon, if you like. And that can employ characteristics or imbue characteristics, again, which are beyond our current scientific understanding, at least in the general norm. There are people and there are underground labs. One of them I've been to in Colorado where they understand some of these principles and they're doing serious research into this. But in John's case, what happened when he built this thing at home, this was back in, was it late 60s, I think? He built this thing on his kitchen table and he was in a rented house. And I'm not sure if it's correct, but I think his landlady might have been upstairs. But once this thing got up to speed and took off, he didn't have and hadn't, it wasn't advanced enough in its development to apply a control and a governing mechanism or to draw off the power at that stage. So yeah. This thing, once it sped up, it displayed.
Balloon.
A balloon. This thing shot up like a rocket through his ceiling, through the roof of the house, gaping hole, never to be seen again. That's it.
Wow.
It's a real boffin in the garden shed story, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, Mark, a lot of our audience are familiar with Nassim Harriman. And tell us about when you were a delegate for the Resonance Foundation.
Well, in fact, coincidentally or synchronistically, Roland, one of my partners in Seattle, he'd also done the same thing. Okay. But I've always been interested in Nassim's work and his outlook and his insight just blew me away. And it's been, to be honest, it's been a long time since I've looked at his work. So I won't talk about it in any detail.
Yeah.
But we engaged with him a number of times, and in fact, one of my partners is still working with him in another company as a science consultant. And so he's still kind of in the outer realms of our collective world. But I know he's still working very hard in developing theories and technologies. One of the things where we mentioned Michael earlier, one of the things Michael brought over to us was one of the toroids.
Yes, I wanted you to tell this story.
Do you remember the toroids? You may have seen it. A stone polo mint, effectively.
A bit like the tube torus, kind of.
Yes,
sonar.
Exactly. Pretty heavy as well, and I won't spoil Michael's story of when he got taken off the aeroplane and all of that.
Will you tell us that story, though?
Say again?
Will you tell us that story about them being taken on the plane?
Oh, okay, in brief. Just because this story adds to the enigma of what the hell is this thing?
Hmm.
Where does it come from? Why is it this shape? Why was it used? Who made it?
Hmm.
And how old is it? So he was bringing it over to the States. Anyway, he'd put it through the baggage and so on and so forth. And they were all on the
plane. Where's it from, Mark? From South Africa?
From South Africa, yeah. He's found a number of these. People even have them as doorstops because they're so prevalent in that area, coupled with the sort of conical stone that he believes they work together. Yeah. Not exactly sure how. There it is. Thanks, Taya. Yeah.
Thanks,
so that's the stone and Michael with it.
Yeah.
And there's plenty of them. I confess, I actually tried sleeping with it under my pillow for about a week just to see if I would get insightful onto its origins and meaning. there's a number of current theories, and I think the strongest relate to it being a component of transforming energies, generating and transmuting energies that are available in the atmosphere and the planet itself. So back to the story, the doors were closed on the airplane, and forgive me, Michael, I hope I'm telling this right, roughly. And on the tannoy, it was asking for their bags. I think it was his partner's bag at the time. It was in her bag. And so the doors opened. He put his hand up, it's my baggage, etc. So he got taken out, down the steps, onto the tarmac, hands on the tarmac, on your hands and knees kind of thing, guns at him, armed police all around, with his bag there in front of him, being ordered to open it up, and they wanted to know what was in it. So he managed to just brush it off as an archaeological find. And somehow it was like, we are not the droids you're looking for. he played his Jedi mind tricks on them, and they put it back in the bag and put it back on the plane and let it go. But something must have triggered that, because he said all the alarms had gone off.
Exactly.
And they couldn't shut it off. Everything just went completely mental. And they had to even close the computer system down and start it up again. Which is interesting, because I had a similar experience with an alien head that I was taking home once. from a conference. I bought this beautiful Zeta Reticulan head that was a beautiful piece of art from Cindy Crawford, I think her name was, the artist, in Arizona. And I had that in my bag. And, of course, that had gone through the X-ray machine. That had set off all the alarms as well, and all the lights were flashing, and they had to take me aside with the bag, and all the guys with the guns and everything came, made me open it. You know, what have you got here? Well, I actually toyed with them for a little bit, because I always think you might as well have some fun with these situations, right? Don't take it too seriously. And so in all the hullabaloo, and they're all red-faced and sweating and very serious, as they should be, about this potential breach of security. So I knew what it was all about, and the bag was there. So before I just went ahead and obliged to their request, I just played them along. I said, yeah, what have you got in the bag? I said, yeah, it's an alien head. So, knowing what kind of confusion it would cause. They said, no, seriously, so what have you got in there? It's just the head of an alien, just taking it home kind of thing. So, okay, please open the bag. Not knowing. So here we are, unwrap it, it was all wrapped up, and just bring it out and show them. And, of course, then they think, well, maybe it's got drugs inside it or something like this. So they just x-rayed it a few times, took it to another machine, eventually gave it back, packed it up, and I was still chuckling as I left. But Michael, too, you know, he got away without any consequences.
So, Taya, just switch our pictures again while I ask Mark the next question. So I was going to ask you about water for gas, because people are probably starting to think, well, what can I do? They're probably people with engineering experience or mechanics, or, you know, we know that cars can run on water. Lots of people have done it. So do you want to just very briefly, because we've still got lots of questions and from the audience as well, can you tell us about water for gas?
Sure. Well, there's a huge... Yeah, I have. There's a huge movement. I try everything if I can. Yeah, yeah. There was a huge movement, and I think it's still ongoing, although I'm not personally following it now, around the generation of, they called it Brown's gas, and it had a number of names, HHO. And essentially it's flammable, and you mix it with air and you can re-inject it. You can generate it on demand in your car from water, and through an electrolysis process, and then you can tube that straight into the intake of your manifold. And so I built one of those here actually a few years ago, and probably about 8 years ago, just with jam jars and tubing and connections to the battery and a little bit of current monitoring, because you don't want to burn anything out. And it hubbles and bubbles away, and you go through a number of stages where the gas becomes a little more dense and refined. And then you're just feeding that bubbled gas into the intake. And what it does is contribute to the combustive process in what seems to be a positive way, in that a number of tests have showed less wear and tear on the engine components, particularly on the cylinder, the rings on the piston cylinders and the valve seats. And I've tried it also on a large diesel engine. And what that did, it had a sort of blanketing effect. The whole thing, all the clanking and the noise that you get inherent with an old diesel engine, leads to large capacity, more of an industrial type diesel engine you might find on large boats and things, on intermediate size. It just completely quietened down. Everything went, oh, sort of nice tickety-boo, rather than clunky clank. And it was. I observed a fuel increase of about, I think I measured about 16-17%.
Wow.
And so in fuel efficiency, and all you're using is water, and you have to top it up because, of course, it's being used. So there's a lot of research in that. But also the problem with that is that with modern cars, you have quite advanced computer and monitoring systems.
Yeah.
And computer controls on many aspects of the engine system. So it's really, and it compensates for itself in any irregularities that it's not designed for.
Yeah, yeah.
So sometimes by applying this kind of thing in a modern vehicle, it messes it up. It really messes up the timing and the governance and the control systems, and the computers don't know how to handle it. Sometimes it can even shut it down. And also people will lose the guarantee and maintenance issues, warranties. We need to be
trying it out on our old bangers, really.
Yeah, yeah, sure. And then, yeah. So I followed that for a little bit, but it was more of a fun technology. For me, it's not, you know, a long-term solution, but certainly it can address. People can do all that kind of stuff at home. There is a plethora of little inventions, things that you can apply for yourself like that. Yeah. Now, you know, back to the mechanical systems earlier, even though I downplay mechanical for a preference towards solid state energy generation. I've recently also engaged with some lovely gentlemen in the UK, and the innovator is an elderly, he just had his 80th birthday a couple of weeks ago. And he has a very interesting mechanical system, which I hadn't contemplated before, which we've done all the usual NDAs and confidentiality agreements. So I've engaged him and another gentleman who's working and supporting us. They've given me permission to replicate it here at home. With the lockdown and everything, it's hard to get access and all the components and parts you want. Yeah. But it's sufficiently simplistic that I can reproduce it here with components I can get off the shelf locally. So I'm actually building something here, and it looks quite promising. Okay. And the current incarnation, I foresee, may generate about 100 watts, up to 100 watts, but it is definitely scalable. And there are some additional side benefits that may come from this technology, not related to energy. So watch this space, and I'll keep you informed as that develops, if it develops positively. A lot of these things don't, you know. And there's so many, well, most of them don't. There's so many reasons along the path to drop it and move on and give up. But you can't. It's my path. It's my passion. It's what I do. And you've got to try everything. And with each failure, if you like, or each time it doesn't work, each mistake, you just learn more, and you can apply that to the next
try. And moving further and further forward. So is this a time in history where the 100th monkey effect mark is crucial? So, like, nothing is a greater example of collective consciousness.
True. I mean, this is one of the components which I love about consciousness and science overlapping, because ultimately consciousness and science will amount to the same thing. You cannot separate ultimately spirituality in its essence and science. You know, they seem to be, to many people, separate issues, and science knows nothing of spirituality and so on. But I do see a convergence, and that's also a part of my passion. And the 100 monkey effect is scientifically demonstrated, a provable issue where and in this scenario, it's where enough people try and become inventive and explorative in this field, ultimately something's going to crack. But also, if a larger number of explorers and inventors are focusing on one thing, where focus goes, energy flows, right?
Yeah,
so ultimately at some point it's going to spark that fire that will then get out of control, and they'll be looking back, and the struggle will be a thing of yesterday. So as long as we, I think for everybody at home, and what we can all do is to maintain that optimistic and open mindset that anything is possible, because it is. There's so much we don't know, and we just need to be open to it and not poo-poo stuff that a lot of people say, a lot of negative things in the various movements like free energy. And when you look into the background and do a bit of fact checking, a lot of people are just naysayers, and they don't know what the hell they're talking about. But sadly, there's other people that don't know anything that listen to them, pay attention, because they've got maybe an engaging manner or a loud voice or a good social media presence. But like all things, especially with news and media these days, we really have to apply a deep sense of discernment. And again, back to the resonance principle, Donald Neil Walsh, spent some lovely time with him and hosted him in Hong Kong many years ago. And one of the principles that he portrayed was, and the focus of our weekend together was, getting to learn about and pay attention to the gut brain, because you can get a lot of intuitive, accurate but very subtle responses from your gut that will take you in a much more holistic and harmonic path with whatever it is you're considering considering. So
I'm bringing a viewer question. So Pamela says, Mark, I love your vision of energy and sovereignty. What and how can we all in this audience do to help this along? And thank you for all that you are being and doing in your efforts for sustainable free energy.
Thank you, Pamela. Well, one of those things is, like I was just saying, the 100th monkey thing is a critical mass of mindset. And we don't know exactly where that critical mass is, but rather than when new ideas and new inventions and things come to light, I think we just need to give them space and respect and consideration for those things to blossom. Sometimes ideas, I've come across so many ideas that are really wacky, really. Okay, and I say wacky in a respectful way, because from the film, when that came out and the DVDs, I was approached by some other lovely people in England who I went to visit. And I was very excited because we were talking about cold fusion, and they had some insight and potential along that developmental line. And I've seen some cold fusion stuff in the States, in a laboratory up in the mountains in Oregon. And so I was intrigued and I went to see it. And the stage that they're at, and I have full respect for it, because I'm a dowser myself and I have done for years, they have dowsed and intuited and had communications from non-terrestrial intelligences, whether we want to call, let's leave that open for now because we don't want to label it necessarily. Yeah. But let's just say and be open to the fact that information can come from many sources. And so through the process and the mechanism of dowsing, they were able to channel their sensitivity to manifest, including the drawings which I've seen, of a three-dimensional field generator coupled with the capacity for a cold fusion reactor. And they've got it down to specific dimensions and even materials. And some of the materials that they doused are not even on our periodic table. There's a few blanks, which is also very interesting because you wonder if this information is a feedback, recursive intelligence feedback loop from the future.
Wow.
Which is a whole another subject we could get into time.
I suppose by us also investing, you know, rather than going down the normal channels of investing money if we have it, is also investing ethically into these sustainable research and development programs.
Absolutely. Well, research and development is a little more difficult to get into because in the investment domain, there's a lot of political issues wrapping those up in terms of proprietorization, intellectual property, and all that kind of thing. But also some of these frontier field work is not in the public domain yet. So it's kind of difficult to support other than be open to look out for ideologically support, at least emotionally support, and be open and just not be on the naysay side.
Yeah.
So it's very simplistic. I appreciate that. And I also appreciate a lot of the stuff does seem quite wacky, and so do some of the characters that present it.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting field. So that's one way. The other way is when emerging technologies do come forward, to, yes, if you've got the cash to invest in them, to spread the word, to bring them into the public consciousness rather than just be fringe consciousness.
Mm.
Because from there, people build documentaries. About these things, and then we're spreading the word literally,
and then literally bringing it into manifestation as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, Marc, we talked earlier about pushing the boundaries, new frontiers. What else is on the horizon for you personally? Anything else piqued your interest out there? Not necessarily with products,
well,
anything? What's your
ambition that I've always held? And okay, what's really exciting me at the moment, and I don't know if you can see on the wall behind me, I've got a whiteboard. I'm building I'm building a lexicon of the all the gods, the pantheons of gods from the different mythologies, and I've been getting deeply with the lockdown. I've been reading a lot of Zachariah Sitchin. And, of course, Michael touches on his work quite a lot in South Africa and the origins of our species, particularly relating, of course, to the Anunnaki or in the Old Testament, the Nephilim. So it's very apparent to me, and I respect people that don't follow or believe any of these sort of the gods and the demigods of the ancient worlds and the archaic kingdoms, but there is so much evidence. It seems to me pretty much undeniable. It's a fact that our past, the earth has been inhabited by technologies and beings not of this earth, visitors. So the Greek mythologies, the Sumerians, the Babylonians, the Egyptians, the Native Americans, all of these cultures have different layers and family groups of gods that essentially seem to relate to similar stories, some of the troubles, some of the difficulties they had interpersonally between them, some of the issues that they brought to the planet are common amongst these mythologies. And Zachariah Sitchin has done a great job, in my opinion, of pulling all these scholarly works and ancient works together, biblical works in particular, because most people can relate to the Bible. And when you translate or reframe some of these ideas and issues, like Enoch, for example, being taken to the Garden of Eden and being taken by these angels, when you transpose that into a different language, and it was eloquently put by Eric von Daniken in a conference in Mexico a few years ago when I went to see him, he put it in the context particularly of the Bible. If you rewrite the whole Bible and you replace, I think it was about 7 or 9 words, and you replace heaven for space, if you replace angel for extraterrestrial, these sorts of things. And then you read it again, the whole story opens up. And it's like, wow, so that's what that means. Oh, I can see that now. I can relate to that. But of course, if you don't believe in aliens and UFOs, then it's still a load of gobbledygook. But for me, it made a lot of it very real, and it allows you to tap into some of the situations that happened. So that's exciting for me right now, because it's bringing in a real tangible connection with our past and where we come from and the origin of our species and potentially our relationship with entities and beings from other realms and other places.
Talking about that, perfect sort of way to come to bring it to an end. John Gilliland, I noticed that he's on the panel with Unify at the moment. He runs ESETI. Yeah. I can't remember what ESETI stands for, but I know they do UFO conferences there every year. So what's anything going on there?
Forgive me, I'm not actually familiar with those guys, but I used to be a part of I used to be a part of ESETI in a sense that, and this was 20 years ago when they were trying to apply a sort of distributed computing power model, allowing you to use a part of your own operating system and computing power to do a search and decode some of the data they've got from the SETI part of Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence.
Yeah.
So it was all a part of that program. But since then, I haven't.
I believe, and please feel free to correct me if I'm not saying it right, but I think Unify from Sunday through to the 14th, they've got a meditation experiment where they're asking extraterrestrials who are in cloaked ships to show themselves. And there's a lot of speakers on that conference. Interesting.
I shall tune in.
Yeah, tune in.
Is this the power feather moment? I'll still be waving yours around. well, of course, the power of collective meditation is a known phenomena to have great effect. And I've been involved in groups with that. And back to your drumming scenario that we did 20 plus years ago. That was all part of that back then. Yeah. So the power of meditation individually on your own psychological and emotional well-being is super powerful. But of course, when we all get that together, back to the 100th monkey effect, when you put all those meditative, peaceful thoughts out there, it's been proven. There's scientific evidence showing the efficacy of this practice. So that'll be very interesting to see. Yeah. I've got a friend who's he's actually in one of our teams, and he has had an experience with some crafts in the sky in his backyard one day, and it was an awakening experience for him. And since then, he's had, as he accounts for it, an open channel for questions and responses, for support and help, which he sometimes taps into and uses for our path to see if we're doing the right thing and whether it's right timing and that sort of thing.
Wow.
So I'm a great believer that, and it's one of my personal ambitions to try and develop that component, because we're so much more than, you know, this bag of bones. And I was thinking about just this morning how ridiculous it is. And I've talked about nature and being in harmony with nature to develop technologies and how harmonious relationships must manifest to bring out the best of that relationship. And it just occurred to me how ridiculous the concept seems that people throw about willy-nilly, that we only use 10% of our brains. Are you bonkers? Does nature really give you the most computing system that we know of, that we cannot replicate? Do you think nature would give you that and just say you've only got 10% of it? I don't think so. So it's really
true. The question is, it's banded around like it's truth.
I know. And the same with junk DNA. Yeah. What a ridiculous concept.
Yeah.
Would nature really give you so much DNA that's junk? And I wish science would come up with this nomenclature that is so misguided and misleading.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it makes the public think, no, it's junk, really does nothing. We're only using this little human genome part of it. No, there's so much more to that. It's a whole tuning fork that taps into the resonance of the creative forces that creates the whole biological system on so many levels. And your spirit.
Human tuning forks.
Yeah.
It's true.
But I think as part of the life creative component, that's the physical representation of the tuning fork between that initiates the conception of the life force that is within us and expresses through us.
Yeah, absolutely. Connecting heaven and earth.
Right.
That's brilliant. So, Mark, I'm going to bring up your slide here. So, this is where you can find out more about what Mark has been talking, which is the quantum power munich.de. And also, if you go to quantumgravityresearch.org, and if you want to email Mark about anything he's talked about tonight, is Marc with a C, Cuthbert@protonmail.com. So I'll put those links into the comments. And if you'd like to sign up to watch Time of the Sixth Sun, the movie and the docuseries for free, you've just got to visit Time of the Sixth Sun launch.com. And if you visit Time of the Sixth Sun movie.com, there's a link where you can donate to help us with the ongoing costs of these monthly live broadcasts. So you can just share these videos with others. It's been, what an interesting hour and a half we've had with you, Mark. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Yeah, for me
I
too.
Finally I finally can see Mark. I wanted to see you.
Well, sorry about that. But I wanted to say to you guys at the beginning, I just wanted to congratulate you, seriously, on this incredible work you've done with the movie. The amount of talent and love that has channeled through you, Nikki, to make this come about, and the contacts and the network that you've created through is absolutely incredible. It's just beautiful work. And Teo, the heart and the love and the generosity of resources that you've poured into this. I feel blessed and honored to know you both and be a part of all of this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mark. Appreciate it. And thank you for your input over the years as well.
My pleasure.
So we will let you know tomorrow who we're having on Thursday. We had a medicine woman, but that's dropped out. So we'll be replacing that with someone. And we'll let you know tomorrow or the next day. Anything else to say, Teo, before we say goodbye to Mark and everyone?
I don't think so. I think, yeah, we'll see you on Thursday night. We had a beautiful speaker lined up for Thursday, but we tested the StreamYard link today and the internet connection just isn't good enough. So we would be fighting against that the whole evening. So we're going to wait to bring that lady forward when we can get her to a place with better internet connection. It's been fascinating, Mark. I always love talking to you. And although a lot of what you talk about goes over my head because my mind doesn't work that way, I love the way you bring it back to day-to-day practical nature that makes it easier for us to understand. So thank you for doing that for us.
Yeah, very grounded. Thank you, Mark. If you stay with us, and for everyone else, we'll see you Thursday night. And also, just to say quickly that we've got another 3 weeks, I think another 6 interviews or 5 interviews now, and then Teo and I are taking a break. He's going off with his family for a couple of weeks, and I'm going to step out too, and then we'll resume mid-August, I believe.
Yeah.
So I'll keep you posted on that on the Facebook page. Mark, thank you. If you just stay with us, Wanda, darling. Good night, everyone.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Good night. Bye, mate.